We're doing a series called Preparing for Battle. I have a question for you. How do you know that you are in spiritual warfare? Let me get some answers. How do you know you're in spiritual warfare? Any hands? No right or wrong answers. Just want to hear what you what you're thinking this morning. Yes.
Would it be you're under stress?
Under stress, okay. That could definitely be a part of spiritual warfare. Anyone else? How do you know when you're in spiritual warfare here and then there? Yes.
A lot of temptations.
Many times more than normal. Very good. Yes.
Feel emotionally tired.
Excellent. Yes, sir.
Alienation from the Holy Ghost.
Alienation from the Holy Spirit. You ever felt disconnected from God? You know, sometimes you can be in church and feel disconnected. Anyone else? A couple more answers. How do you know that you're in spiritual warfare? All right. Very good. Give yourselves a hand. Excellent. Very good. Well, do better than that. Don't be a hater because you didn't have any answers. And we're going to find out that this is very important, it is critical, it is crucial, because the only thing worse than being in a battle, or being in a war, or being in a dangerous situation is being in that situation and not knowing it. How many married people now? Okay, I'm married too. It's good to know when your wife's mad at you, amen? When your husband's upset, it's good. So you kind of prepare yourself for the discussion. What you don't want is a Bobbitt situation. You can Google that and yourself, where you think everything is peaceful, everything's fine, and the next morning you found out you've been attacked. And so what the enemy is counting on, he's counting on the fact that the church is sleeping.
Yes.
And when do we sleep? Like Samson, he thought Delilah was his woman. He thought Delilah cared about him. So he fell asleep in her arms and he was not defending himself because he did not realize he was in battle. The best way to beat someone is to sucker punch them. Come on now. Even though it's wrong, but the enemy doesn't have rules. Satan doesn't have rules that he plays by. You don't get to ring the bell and the devil says, okay, I'll give you 5 minutes. The enemy is always after us. He is relentless. And many times when it seems like nothing's going on, that's when something's really going on. And so our church, our ministry is here, and for no other reason to prepare you for battle. Prepare you for battle. We're going to go ahead. We're going to look at Ephesians chapter 6, starting with verse 10. And we're going to go through and we're going to talk about a couple of these verses and then we're going to close out here not too long from now. But I want you to follow with me and what is the style of ministry I'm doing today? I told you the answer at the beginning is what? It is teaching. So you might not shout, you might not holler, you might not run around the church. It's kind of small to do that here. Amen. You just got to pretend. But what we're doing is we're gathering information that God wants to give us so we can be a what? An overcomer, right? Someone said an achiever. That's good too. But an overcomer, because we want to win. Why go to war if you're not going to win? Don't even show up, please. So we need to win, period. There's nothing else but winning. Verse 10 says, finally, be strong in the Lord and his mighty power. It says, put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against authorities, against the powers of this dark world, against spiritual forces of evil in heavenly realms. Therefore, put on the full armor of God so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground. And after you've done everything to stand, then you can stand firm, and it goes on. But basically, we're talking about this portion. Next Sunday, we'll continue it, and we'll talk about the actual armor that you put on to overcome the enemy. Let's go back to verse 10, please. The word finally. Whenever you see that word finally, number one, it is drawing your attention. It is saying, you know, I've said a whole bunch of stuff, but, you know, I need you to pay attention to this right here. I need to make sure that you don't miss this right here. Because sometimes we can disconnect, we can fall asleep. So Paul is saying, this is very important. Don't leave this out. Focus on this. Pay attention. Then it goes on to say, be strong. You need to be strong. I need to be strong. Being weak spiritually is not good. It is completely unacceptable. It is not helpful to you at all. It is not God's plan for your life to be weak spiritually. Now, the Bible doesn't say get strong. It says what? Be strong. And the word be means a place of constant existence. When you be, that's incorrect English, but when you be, that means you exist. That you exist. We need to be strong in the Lord all the time. We need to be in a place of strength all the time. Now let's talk about Samson again. You know, I said in the earlier service, I think Samson invented the Harlem Shake and also the Jiggy Dance, because whenever he would get in trouble, whenever he would have a problem, he would start shaking himself. Now here's how it worked. This was Old Testament, Samson, who probably looked like John. Can you stab John real quick? Okay, Samson had long hair, like that, didn't cut his hair, all right. So that's our Samson for today, okay, you can be seated. He wants to honor anybody with my autograph now. So what happened was Samson, God gave him a gift of physical strength. And whenever he needed to use that strength, he would shake himself. They're probably like, just, you know, someone's getting mad, we start going like this. So he just shook himself and all this strength would come in. Now the problem with Samson is he would only shake himself when he thought he was in trouble. Remember we said one of the greatest schemes of the enemy or plans of the enemy is for you to put your dukes down because you think that it's time for peace. You're not paying attention. And some of us are like Samson because the only time we go to church is when? Right. When we get in trouble, something's going wrong. Some of us are like that. God, I know it's been a while since, you know. And you know what? He loves you. He'll listen to you. But the goal is to have that consistent relationship with him. That you're not just shaking yourself because of a problem. You're always strong. You remain strong. You stay consistent. You stay connected. Amen? Because you don't know where and when and how the next attack is coming, so you need to always be ready. In our nation's history, I believe it was during the Revolutionary War, there were a group of men who were always ready to fight, and who knows what that group was called?
Minutemen.
The Minutemen. That means within 1 minute, if somebody said the British are coming, because back then the British were our enemy. Somebody said the British are coming, within 1 minute, they were outside, they were ready to fight, they were ready to go. And as Christians, we need to be the same way. Don't let the enemy catch you in your pajamas. Amen. So finally, be strong, stay strong, and then strong in what? It says in the Lord. In the Lord. Now, why is this important? Because some of us understand the concept of being strong, but we're strong when it comes to working out. And we're strong when it comes to exercises. We're strong when it comes to sports. You know, especially guys like me. My kids haven't beaten me yet in basketball. That's right. This boy right here, who turned 15 today, he has not beaten me yet in basketball. That's because I haven't played him since he was 11. Amen. I'm holding on to the championship, and I will not defend it because I don't have to. I will be the champion. But as we get older, we say, man, I need this young blood beat me, so I might work out, I might do something to prepare for it. So we understand, right, in our workplace, you know, you're not going to get promoted if you don't keep up with the information. Just because they hired you doesn't mean the technology is going to be current 20 years from now. And so we understand what it means to be strong, right, or to stay strong in education, in exercise, in our job, in our looks. Some of us dress strong. We don't just walk out of the house. I mean, everything's got to match. Everything's in place. We look a certain way, and that takes a lot of work. Some of us had to go into the closet 15 times, amen, till we found an outfit where the button didn't just burst, amen, once we put it on. So by the time we showed up, we went through a lot to make sure that we are strong in that particular area. But when it comes to spiritual things, oh, God will take care of that. It'll just work out. God says, no, no, no. You know how to work out naturally. It's important to work out spiritually so you can remain strong. Remain strong. Then it says, in his mighty power. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. This is the cool part, because God's saying that there's no way you can overcome the enemy by yourself. So he's not saying that you have to fight the devil. He's saying be strong in him and that he will fight the devil for you. He's already the champion. He's already the overcomer. But the principle is he wants you to have a relationship with him. He wants you to be connected. You know, I don't feel bad to ask my wife or my kids you know, to get me a glass of water or do something for me. Do you know why? Because I have a relationship with them. My wife didn't have to say, honey, can I get $10 or babe, can you know what? We don't have to talk like that to each other because it hasn't been 50 days since we spoke. Some of us, our relationship is awkward with God. Why? Because you haven't talked to him in a year. It needs to be awkward. You need to feel weird going to him. I don't feel weird going like, God, I need another car. Hook me up. Hook your man up. Hook your bro up. Why? Because we hang out in other areas. We already have a relationship. We're already connected. I don't have to feel strange going to my Heavenly Father because I have a relationship with him. So he's saying, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. You can't overcome the enemy. God can, but he's saying you have to have a strong relationship with him in order for this to work. You need the Lord's help. You need his strength. Then it goes on to say, put on the armor. I'm going to talk about what the armor is next Sunday. But let's talk about this. So if it says put on the full armor, then indirectly it's telling you what? That it's possible to do what? Right, it's possible to put on a partial armor. If not, it wouldn't emphasize full. We just say either put it on, take it off. But it says put on the full armor. This means it's possible to do a partial armor. Now, what would cause us to put on a partial armor instead of the whole thing? Let's see some hands. Yes, sir.
We haven't prayed enough to put on the full armor.
Okay.
We're worthy enough for the armor.
Say it again. Let me get more of that. Say it again. You said what, the last part?
We don't think we're worthy of the armor, so we don't put it all the way on.
Okay. That could be something. Very good. Yes, sir. And then over here, yes.
Picking and choosing what part we want to do and not do.
Okay, picking and choosing what part we're going to do or not do, and why would that be? What are some reasons why we might pick and choose what we're going to do or not do? Do you have something here?
Yeah, you're too comfortable in the state that you're already in.
Excellent. You're too comfortable in the state that you're already in. Very good. Anyone else? Because this is good. It's better when you respond, the teaching works better.
Doubt.
Say it again?
Doubt.
Doubt. So in other words, why go through all the trouble of putting this on? It's not going to work anyway. Right? It might not work anyway. Very good. Why even show up to class? I'm going to fail anyway. All right? Very good. That's the wrong answer. Very good. Somebody else. What are some reasons why we put on some of the armor and not all of it? Way in the back and then over here. Way in the back.
You might feel like you don't need it.
Very good. Excellent. And see, this is the deception of the enemy. I don't need that. I got this part. Okay? And that's where we deceive ourselves. And the enemy is hoping that you'll do that. The enemy is hoping that you do that. Yes?
Not being sure where the attack is going to come from, so just guessing.
Very good. So you think, well, the attack's going to come this way, so I'll fortify this area, not realizing the enemy might come through the back door. Over here.
You might think that the full armor would restrain your movement.
Okay. It might cramp your style. Okay. We don't mind repping Christ as long as it has to do with something that is agreeable to the world or that kind of makes sense. And a lot of us as Christians, we're kind of stuck right now because We you know, it's hard for me to post every scripture that I might want to on Facebook because people might not understand. And so I find myself sometimes like, Lord, it's hard to touch on this area and that area. But as the Church of Jesus Christ, we need to talk about all areas. Are you following me? Very good. Yes, anyone else? What are some reasons why we don't put the full armor all the way in the back?
We count on somebody else to have it on for us.
Good. We kept Grandma prayed for me. Well, Grandma, when to be the Lord, what you going to do now? You know, so somebody else will come in. Pastor's got that. My wife will take care of that. Very good. Anybody else? Yes, ma'am?
Laziness.
That's good. Because it takes effort to put on the armor. That's right. Anyone else? Yes, sir?
Not knowing what the full armor is.
Excellent. Not knowing what it is. I'm glad you said that. That's one of the things I have written down. Because some churches do not give you the full armor. Some ministries don't give you the full armor. They just give you what's going to get the tithes and offerings coming through the door. Amen. Here we want to tell you the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. So help us God. That's what Revive Church is all about. Anybody else quickly? And let's give God a hand. You did very well. Amen. Excellent. Very good. Very good. So you said laziness, slothfulness, carelessness, a sense of false security. For some of us, it's disobedience. We know what we're supposed to do, and we just rebel. I'm just not going to do it. And then sometimes it's ignorance and not even knowing that it's available or what it is. Okay, the next verse, and we're going to go here to verse 13, put on the full armor. So when the evil day comes, you will stand your ground let me see, stand against the devil's schemes. Forgive me. Verse 11. So put on the full armor of God, verse 11, so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. So understand, the enemy is always plotting. This is a smart devil. He doesn't just come running out the door and running at you. He has planned. He has strategized. He has observed the areas that you are weak in. And he always wants to do what is not fair. So the devil will attack you. So you have to be ready to stand and defend yourself against his attacks. One thing about spiritual warfare, you don't have to agree to be in the warfare. And there is no timeout. The enemy is coming after you, your home, your marriage, your family, your health, your finances, whether you like it or not, so you may as well be ready. Okay? Then, what kind of warfare is this? The Bible says that we're wrestling not against flesh and blood. So that just simply means the attacks are not in the natural realm. So natural weapons like your fists, guns, knives, even your mouth, cannot defend you against these types of attacks. Now, you can declare the word of God with your mouth, but I mean the whole complaining or yelling or screaming or cussing people out, that's not going to help you overcome in this battle, because it's not a natural battle, it's a spiritual battle. You can't see it with your eyes, you can't touch it with your hands. Then it goes on to say this, for our struggle is not against flesh and blood, verse 12, but against rulers, against authorities, and against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in heavenly realms. Now, this is the part where I think most of the time we go to church, we just kind of accept what the pastor says, we clap our hands, we write songs about it, you know, we get all excited, and then we leave, but we really don't understand what spiritual warfare is, or what spiritual warfare looks like. Now, how do you know that you're in spiritual warfare? I'm going to give you an example here in a minute. But let's break down these words, because I'm going to make it simple. The first word is ruler. Ruler. What is a ruler? One who has dominion and supreme control over a territory. So you are dealing with a spiritual entity that feels that it has control and dominion over you, your family, your choices, your future, your destiny. So there is a mindset that the enemy has, right? Now, in our nation, America, and many other places, there's a certain kind of trafficking. We have kids here, so I don't have to say the whole entire phrase. But there's a certain kind of trafficking that takes place. And usually when people get caught up in that lifestyle, it begins with the person befriending them, right? Befriending them, talking to them, and all of a sudden, they put them through a process where the person feels like they're now a piece of property. See, the enemy, he feels that way about you. You can go to church all you want, get all the degrees you want, you know, make all the money you want, but he knows, he just has to say a certain word in your ear, and you start feeling very low about yourself. You start feeling very little about it. He says, yeah, you're doing this, but I remember what you did last year. Or I remember what you did when you were 15. I remember what you did when you were 12. I remember what your uncle did to you. And he takes you back to that place where you start saying, man, there's nothing that will make me rise up from this feeling of doubt and fear. And I'm here to tell you, that's spiritual warfare. The enemy feels like he is your ruler, and he wants you to feel the same way. The next word is authority. Authority is the legal right to give orders, make decisions, and enforce obedience. So Satan is interested in being an authority in your life. And he feels like he has the legal right because we haven't been perfect. Because we've sinned before. And so he'll just say, no, man, you know, you're not an overcomer. Look at the sins you committed. I'm not going to make you raise your hand, but some of us committed sins yesterday or even this morning on the way to church, whatever that sin might be. And that spiritual warfare is wrestling with that, because someone can only be an authority in your life if what? That's it. If you make them or let them be an authority. There are folk who are locked up in prison, but they're free in their hearts. There are. There's folk who are on death row who are like, hey, man, I should have done it, but I found Jesus. I'm happy to have the joy of the Lord. I'm not confined by these bars on the outside, because on the inside I'm free. Some of us are not living in prison on the outside, But on the inside, we feel constrained. Why? Because we've allowed the enemy to become an authority. See, when someone's an authority or something's an authority, it gets a chance to speak into your life. It gives you direction. It, you know, you're kind of afraid to do something unless it gives you permission. Spiritual warfare is we want to break all of those curses, break all of those ties, and really be free from the enemy. Not just religious. You can come to church and be in bondage in your heart. You can call yourself a Christian and still be in bondage in your heart. We want to be free on the inside, on the outside. We want to be free every which way you can imagine. You know, at one point in our nation's culture, you had the Emancipation Proclamation. So the declaration was made. But for many of those folk, it was like, so what? Be free and do what? Be free and get shot? Be free and get it? You know, so you knew you were free, but you went right back to where you were because you did not know how to be free. And so God wants us, whom the Son has made free is what? Free indeed. Not just in concept, not just in philosophy, but completely free. And so the spiritual warfare is to stay free, is to feel free, to know that you are free, to experience freedom, not just the proclamation of freedom, but to actually have that freedom and possess it. The word power is the capacity or ability to direct or influence the behavior of others or the course of events. And so we're fighting against powers that are out there to influence our decisions. If you read scripture, the devil did not hogtie Eve and shove the fruit in her mouth. Because it wouldn't have been sin. If something is against your will or against your choice, it cannot be sin, because sin by definition has to be a decision. So what he does is he influences us. He pushes us. He taunts us. He deceives us so that we would make a decision to sin, which now puts us in further bondage. And God wants his people to be completely free. The word force. In physics, force is something that causes a change in the motion of an object. Any interaction that, when unopposed, will change the motion of an object. Force is an invisible pressure. And so the enemy is influencing, he's lying, he's deceiving, but he's also using force. He's pressuring you to do the wrong thing, to say the wrong thing, to go to the wrong places. His goal is to use influences to force us in the wrong way. Now, in the King James, it talks about principalities, powers, wickedness in high places. And a principality is an area that is controlled by a prince. That's where principality comes from. And so Satan feels like your home belongs to him. Your marriage belongs to him. Your life belongs to him. He has set aside territory. Now, can I give you a good natural example of this? Okay, if you work for a company that does sales, especially maybe a company like Verizon or something like that, usually the salespeople will have what is called territories. Now, they may not own that area, but that's their responsibility. So there are demons and devils, principalities and powers that has marked your house, your life, as a part of its territory, and it's working to destroy your life. You've been targeted. Now, all of this should give you an uncomfortable feeling so you'll defend yourself. The neighborhood where I live is a very good neighborhood, a good place. We moved there on purpose, but about a year ago or so, there were a couple of kids who were actually breaking into houses, and that wasn't normal for our area. So all of a sudden, people were getting like alarms put on their houses. Some folk were buying guns. People were just kind of like bugging out, because we understood that for whatever reason, we had now become targeted. And so we responded to that. Situation was taken care of. Kids were arrested. You know, that's not going on anymore at the particular point in time. But why does it take something happening before we listen to the word of God? Let's just prepare ourselves spiritually, because the enemy has targeted you because you're a child of God. The enemy has targeted you because he hates anyone who has joy. How many of you have fought to be successful in your life? The enemy hates that. The fact that you have some success, he wants you down there with him. Why? because he has fallen. He is no longer successful. He was repoed. He was kicked out. He was evicted. He's in poverty. His future doesn't look too good. So he wants a bunch of folk that he can hang out with who don't have a good future either. Well, I'm here to tell you, devil, that none of us are going to be a part of that party.
Amen.
We're going to prepare ourselves to defend ourselves against the attacks of the enemy. I'm going to give you one last verse here, and then we're going to close out. Let's go ahead and go with Ephesians chapter 2, verse 1 through 4. It says, "As for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins, in which you used to live when you followed the ways of this world and of the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. All of us also lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our flesh and following its desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature deserving wrath, but because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved." So God is simply saying, look, before you came to him, before you met him, you knew how life was. And let's be real, sometimes sin has certain aspects of interest. Might seem like it's fun sometimes, but if you think really hard, isn't it funny how you remember the good part of sin, but you forget about the other part? When you got arrested or they were trying to shoot you or you were throwing up, you forget about that part, right? Or you was in the doctor's office, you forget about that. The enemy just tries to remind you of the stuff that looks like it's fun. I always say the beer commercials only show you the first half, right? They forget about the other part where the person is throwing up the next morning, you know, or they've crashed their car into a tree. They kind of edited that part of it, you know, for it to come out. So God said, look, that was your old life. It was your old lifestyle. And we're not judging those who are in the world because we used to all be in the world. Come on now. We used to be in the world. That was a part. And even some of us, after we got saved, found ourselves going back in the world. So we're not putting people down, but we're saying, remember the bondage of being in the world and don't go back to that. His grace and his mercy has set us free from that. Let us keep moving forward. And next week, we're going to talk about putting on the armor of God, what it looks like, and how it will help you to overcome all of these principalities, all of these powers, all of these forces, all of these things that have been sent your way to bring destruction to your life. We're going to talk about how you can overcome those things. Bow your heads and close your eyes. Heavenly Father, we thank you and we praise you, God, for all that you've done for us and all that you're doing. Lord, our hearts are focused on you. Our minds are focused on you. And God, we trust you. We need your help. We need your leadership and your guidance. For some of us, we're just beginning the journey of life. But for others of us, we know what it feels like to fail. And we don't want to fail again. We don't want to go back to a place of disaster and destruction. We want to learn from the first time. So this time we can do it better. If you're here today and you don't know Christ Jesus as your Savior, or maybe you're just not sure about it, you know, we're not going to force you to join our church. We don't want your money at this time. This is not an offering moment. But this is a time where you think to yourself and say, you know what? I want to make sure that Christ is living in my heart. I want to make sure that I'm connected to the God of heaven through a relationship. And the Bible says it begins Romans chapter 10, verse 9 and 10, simply believing in your heart, confessing with your mouth, and you are saved. You're born again, just like that. Doesn't take a whole lot, but it does take a little. And the little is responding to his voice and responding to him. If you're here today and you say, you know, Pastor Doss, that's me. I'm not saved, I'm not born again, or I'm not sure. And I want to make sure my life is right with God today. And we would like to take a moment to pray with you right where you're seated. But would you please let us know that by just raising your hand. Say, Pastor, that's me. I want to make sure my sins are forgiven. My sins are washed away. I see your hand. I want to make sure that my life's right with God, that Christ Jesus is seated at the center of my heart. Anyone for that prayer, just put your hand up. Anybody else? Either for the first time or you're renewing your relationship with the Lord. I see your hand. I see your hand. I see your hand. Anybody else? I see your hand. Anyone else care to join them today? I see your hand. It's a free invitation. Six people so far. Once again, I don't want anything from you. This is a free gift. But the Bible says you have to receive it. You have to receive it. Sometimes a package gets stamped, return to sender. It was set, but it wasn't brought into the house, so it's taken back. Jesus Christ is a free gift, but you have to receive that gift. Is that a hand? I see your hand. Anybody else? About 7 people today making a decision for Christ, either for the first time or renewing their relationship with Him. That's what church is all about. Anyone else? In America, we made church about frying chicken and collecting offerings, but in Revived Church, it's about lives being changed, transformed by the power of the Holy Spirit. Anyone else for the prayer? Amen. There might be maybe one more person. You're wrestling, you're struggling. It's not about being religious. You might say, well, I don't understand all this. I don't either. I know enough to know I need Him. That's what I know. And I'm still learning every day. We all learn until we go to be with Him. But it begins with knowing enough to say, there's an empty place in my heart. Drugs can't fill it. Women can't fill it. Men can't fill it. Money can't fill it. Education can't fill it. Joining every organization can't fill it. Only God can fill it. God wants to fill that emptiness. But you've got to ask Him. And the Bible says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If you will answer it, I will come in and I will be with you. Anyone else for this prayer? Please put it up. We're about to pray. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Those of us who raised our hands and those of us who have a relationship with Christ already, let's say this prayer together as we celebrate with them what God's doing in their life. Say, Lord Jesus, I thank you for dying on the cross to save me from my sins, for paying a price that I couldn't pay. It was too expensive, but you paid it for me. I receive the free gift of love, forgiveness, and salvation. Thank you for it. In Jesus' name I pray. Somebody give God some praise. Come on, somebody give God some praise.